Princess D had everything a princess could want, except her mother. Her mother had died, and she missed her mother badly. She was so happy to be there for her father, and she watched how he struggled and how sad he became. So when he began to date a woman, she was pleased because he smiled again. And so they were married, and now she had a stepmother. Now there was another queen. But she wasn't certain she liked her. She was pleasant around her, of course, and civil, because you have to be that way. She was raised to be like that. But Princess D wanted so much for her stepmother to be there with her. Here she was, 17 years of age. Life was changing, and she needed an older woman to stand with her, because her father sometimes was just difficult. One day, after talking with some of her princess friends, they had written letters to each other, and they had decided that the next year, each one of them would get to that age where marriage was be required. And after writing to each other, they had decided that they should take a trip by themselves without their fathers or their mothers, or in her case, stepmother, and they should go off to a monastery in Spain near a beach and spend some time just as young ladies. At dinner that evening, she looked at her father and said, "Daddy, I've been talking with the other princesses. You know them, don't you? The princess of Montego and the princess of Trinidad and the princess, you know them." "Yes, yes, yes. What have you all girls been hatching up this time?" "Daddy, we're not hatching anything. We just know that next year you're going to be asking if I'm going to get married, and they're the same way with their fathers. So we've decided that we want to go off and we want to have some time together, just as girls. And we found a great monastery. It's in Spain. It's near a beach. There won't be anybody there." "Absolutely not. No, we're not having this discussion. What do you mean? No, you're not going anywhere. Nowhere. Do you understand me? No." "But Daddy, Daddy, why can't I go? Why can't I just be a girl for a little while?" "You are not a girl. You are a princess. Now, what is that supposed to mean? I am a girl, about to be a woman, and I want time for myself." At that, Princess D looked toward her stepmother, who sat across the table from her, and said, Tell him what it feels like to be an independent woman, which you were before you were married. Tell him." But her stepmother simply looked down at her plate and didn't say a word. Princess D rolled her eyes, and inside she thought, "See, I knew this woman would never support me. Daddy, I'm going to go. Not if I have anything to do with it. And I do." With that, he banged his fists on the table, and Princess D finished eating her food between breathing deeply through her nostrils, saying, "Excuse me," as quickly as she could, and running to her room, where she flounced across the bed and cried. The next morning, she came downstairs, eyes puffy still from her cry the night before. She sat down to the breakfast that was put before them. She looked across the table at her stepmother. Her stepmother looked at her and nodded and smiled. Princess D smiled back, but it wasn't real. It was just what she was supposed to do, perfunctory. And her father came in, sat down. "Dee, I've been doing some thinking, and I don't like this idea. You going with the girls to Spain. But it is a monastery." "Yes, Daddy, it is a monastery. And we'll be very safe. You know those nuns won't let anything happen to us." "Yes, I know that. And you will take two guards with you." "Oh, no, sir. Not two guards. You know that one of the guards, she's a female. She taught me the one to ride the horses. You know how well I ride, Daddy. And she's a good hunter, too. She could be one of your guards if it... Oh, I'm not certain about that. I'm not certain. She would be wonderful, and she could be with me every moment. And each one of us will have a woman that will be with us. Daddy, please. Her eyes, they had that look like puppy dogs. It had gotten her father in trouble many times before. And so, yes. Stop looking at me like that. Go. When is this time going to be? 2 months. We've decided 2 months. That way we can gather everything. And of course, we want to contact the monastery and say that we're coming and such. And oh, Daddy, you're wonderful. You're wonderful. And with that, Princess D flashed a look over at her stepmother as if she had won a battle. And then she got up from the table and hugged her father. Man, breakfast was more pleasant after that. And so she did. Princess Dee and the other princesses, they traveled with their individual woman assigned to them, and off to the monastery they went. And there the girls laughed and talked. They dreamed of love. They dreamed of what their life would be as queens, knowing their duty, but also of what they could make and give and serve, and also the fact that they wanted to choose who they would marry without their father's assistance. They came back home. All of them, and Princess Dee was one of those who came home. And in arriving home, she talked that evening incessantly, looking across at her stepmother to emphasize how much it was good to be an independent woman. And her stepmother smiled and nodded her head. Well, it sounds like it was good for each of you. It was, Daddy. And so I have decided that on my 18th birthday, I'm going to have a great ball. Well, of course, it's your 18th birthday. It's time for you to start looking for a husband. Yes, me looking for a husband. Well, what do you mean, you? Me choosing who I'm going to love. I don't want to be told who to marry. What do you mean? I have perfectly fine princes that have been set up to talk to you and to court you properly. I even have some lords who have some sons that I wouldn't mind you being with. I don't know if I want a prince or a lord or a duke or earl or any of those things. I might want the man in the stable, or I might want the cook, or I might want the... Her father could barely speak. The cook? The stable hand? Child, have you lost your mind? What did you girls do down there? We discussed that it is our right to choose who we will love, that we have been trained well enough that we can be queens without someone who has been trained to be a king. Who put that nonsense in your head? That will not happen. At this ball that you are going to have, only the men that I prescribe may come. Father, it is my birthday and my ball, and I will allow anyone that I want to come, and I will choose from anyone who I want to love, just like you got to choose, young lady. And with that, Princess D looked at her stepmother. He chose you. And you were not from the most fashionable of families. You're a good woman, yes. Certainly not a duchess. Certainly not one of the ladies. A good woman from a good family. Don't you think it's my right to choose? And the stepmother looked across the table at Princess Dee, and her eyes welled with tears, but she lowered her head. I knew it. You would say nothing to me. And Princess Dee looked back at her father. I will make my plans. With or without you, Father, then you will make them without me and without the luxury of the treasury I hold in my power, young lady. Father, you would deprive me of that young lady. I can't believe you would do that to me. And up the stairs she ran again, through the door, and she flounced again across the bed, tears in her eyes. But this time more than tears. Oh, Mommy. Mommy, if you were just here, you would know. Why aren't you here? She was late coming down for breakfast and had indeed missed all of breakfast, and her hair was still disheveled and she had not picked her finest of gowns to wear. Young lady, come down to our breakfast like that again, and I will assure you that I will have someone else dress you. I'm sorry, good sir. Is there any food I might call upon? And the stepmother raised her hand, and there was food that was brought out to Princess D. It was still warm. She smiled, but Princess D didn't see it. D, you may have the ball. It's fine, thank you. And you may invite whomever you desire. Dee's fork was up in the air, and suddenly she clattered it onto the plate and said, sir, you may invite whomever you desire, except for someone that works in the kitchen. They should be in the kitchen helping to put food on the table. Daddy, might I invite one or two of them? Ugh, child. You do drive me to near insanity. I drive you to near love. Ugh, this is what they call love. Give me insanity. Daddy. May I invite anyone? And you will not decide for me? You will allow me to dance with all, to talk to all? Her father gulped loudly and obviously. And then he put his back against the chair and with a deep sigh, his head up in the air. Yes, Dee, I will allow it. And at that moment, Princess Dee noticed her stepmother put a hand on top of her husband's hand. And Dee thought, of course, you support him in his sadnesses. But never me. But quickly she wiped that from her mind. She ate the food and ran to the kitchen to begin to talk about the meal that would be had for her birthday, which was not but 2 months off. And the plans were made. Every day was built on the plans, how the ball would look, how the room would look, who would be invited. The invites were sent out far and wide. Her friends came over the night before so they could all be together, dressed in their finest. Oh, some of their fathers had been most discouraged by what this king had done, because now all of their daughters wanted to find their own husbands. What nonsense was that? And so everybody bustled around, and the day of the ball came. She bounded down the stairs, Princess Dee did, making sure everything was right, watching as her stepmother made sure that the dishes were correct and that the plates were in the right place and that the decorations were on the wall. But never a once did she turn to look at her stepdaughter, to look at me. And she bounded back up the steps a little slower, wishing her mother was there to see her. And after all the girls had dressed that evening, as the gentlemen came, she could hear them all being introduced by the butler in the hall and the king welcoming them and the queen beside them, nodding in assent. And when the young ladies came down the staircase, with her being the last to come down in her bright yellow gown that had lace over it and had greenery on the sides, with her small tiara on her head and a train that came from behind it. Oh, she was beauty. Even her father couldn't stop his heart. My dear, you are quite the woman, like your mother. May I have the first dance with you? She blushed, nodded yes, and her stepmother looked at those that had been gathered to play and onto the floor. He came with her father. And then the ball began in earnest, and all kinds of dancing and steps and movements were done. But there was one that caught Dee's eye. Well, he was a duke's son. But he was broad-shouldered, just a little taller than himself. His ears were just a little big. But she thought it made him better at listening, because he deeply listened to her. And when they danced, he wanted to know her life. He did not brag on all that he had and all that he could offer, as every other young man seemed to do. No, he listened to her. And when she said she had dreams of her own, he did not laugh about why a queen would need dreams. He simply listened, and at one point said, I do believe women could have their own dreams. And I know that there have been times that a queen has certainly been a better leader than a king. She liked him. And although he was a little further away, she told him she would like to see him again. And he said he would come, with her father's permission. She danced with others that night, but always made her way back to the duke's son. When the night ended and everyone left, and just the young ladies who were princesses bustled back into the rooms above and sat in the hallways talking to each other before going to the rooms, each of them thinking about who it might be that they might love. But they had all watched Princess Dee. They had all seen her eyes on the Duke's son. And they all were happy for her. The next day, the girls left to their own palaces, and she floated around the castle. Floated and said nothing. She had meals with her parents and said nothing, but her eyes and her mind were far off. It was a few days before she said thank you to her father and her stepmother, and then that's when she approached it. I have asked the Duke's son to come and visit. He has agreed to come next week at this time. We will have lunch together, and then he and I will go for a walk in the garden by ourselves. But by yourselves. Up to this point, her father had been half listening, just eating as he was. By yourselves? That is not proper or appropriate. You will not be by yourselves. I will have two guards around you. Any harm that comes to you, he could defile you, child. Defile you. Father, he is not going to defile me. And I am fine. I can stand up for myself, and I will, and we will talk. We do not need others to hear our conversation. Well, what if he should lean in to kiss you? Well, then I shall accept the kiss. You will not accept the kiss! This is improper and shall not happen. I will send message to the Duke himself and tell him his son is not to come, nor ever to cross this threshold again. Do you hear me, young lady? She stood up from the table. She leaned into her father. I hear you, sir, and I disagree. I will not allow myself be told who I can love and not. And I have earned every right to be trusted with whomever I am with. Have I ever caused you harm? Have I ever brought disgrace on this house? Not I, sir. She stood there and they looked eye to eye. In that moment, had they even had a moment to think about it, they would have seen how much alike they were. Stubborn to the core, but stubborn over love. And she turned. Princess D's turned her head. Speak for me, stepmother. Speak for me. I have never caused you harm. I accepted you when you came into the family to take the place of my mother. I have watched the joy you have given my father. And yet not once have you spoken on my behalf. Not once have you said anything that would provide me a moment of joy. If my mother was here. Young lady, you will cease that right now. If my mother was here, she would be here for me. And the princess dropped into her chair. Her head in her hands, sobbing. Speak for me. And she lifted up her eyes from her hands and she looked at her stepmother, whose head was held down. And if she had looked closer, she would have seen the tears. But Princess D didn't look close. I am worth nothing to you. And from the table, she leapt, ran out the door of the great hall, slamming it behind her, and out she went. Guards, follow her. Outside, she cried for a while. While she walked, knowing that a foot behind her were two guards. She would leave now. She had determined that. Her time here in the castle was done. She would tell them shortly that she would take her things. She would find her way to the convent and stay there until she had been properly married or decided to become a nun herself. But to live under her father's roof with that woman would not continue. After some time, she began her walk back to the castle. She opened the door quietly. And as she passed the great hall, the door was opened. And she heard a voice she had not heard in a long time. My king, your daughter is just like you. Stubborn, determined, and wise, and trustworthy. That girl, she does not understand. She wants to grow so quickly. And you, the king, you will stop her from growing? Oh, I did not know you had that power. Princess D could hear her father laugh and chuckle to himself. She loved that laugh. But then she heard her stepmother speak on. My love, my king. What has your daughter ever done to prove herself less than trustworthy? Oh, it is not her. It is what has she done? I have not asked you to think about the Duke's son. He is a proper young man. He will do no harm to her, and you know such, for you would kill him if he did. Well, that is true. I do have that power. Yes, you do have some power. But if you continue in what you are doing on the path that you have laid out for yourself, you will find yourself without a daughter. She could hear her father, Princess D, could hear her father lean up in the chair and heard his big elbows go on the table. He was leaning forward. And she heard her stepmother say, "Now, I do believe it is your choice, but if I were you, I would not lose her because of my stubbornness." She heard a chair move and realized, just as she saw through the door, that her father's chair was moving closer to her stepmother. And he leaned over to her, picked up her hand, and kissed her on the hands and said, "You have known my daughter better than I have." When she wanted to go to that trip in the monastery, had you not spoken up, she would not have gone. And that's because you know nothing of a young lady's heart to want to know herself. And then that ball. Oh, that young man dancing with her all night long. And all that foolishness about bringing in the stable hands and such. Yes, and she chose wisely. How long have you looked at the Duke's son and thought he would be a good catch as a son-in-law? Well, of course, I couldn't say anything about that. And now she wants this that is not proper, but it is proper for her soul. And you, as her father, you will love her. I tell you, you see my daughter better than I do. I am glad I married you. Oh, you need to be glad you married me. Else you would be fighting with your daughter every day. I love you, my king. And you, my queen. Princess Dee looked only a moment longer as she saw them kiss. She ran up to her room. And she flounced on her bed. But this time, when she cried because she had not known. She cried because she had not given grace. And she cried because she could have had an ally, but chose her to be enemy. That evening at dinner, she came downstairs, a proper dress on and a beautiful gown, her hair done nicely, her eyes cleared up. She came to the great hall. She sat across from her stepmother. And as the food was brought in, the king said, "Dee, you may write the Duke's son back and tell him he is welcome here. I have already written the Duke and said that I have been in agreement. And you may walk after the lunch that we have. You may walk in the rose garden with him. For 30 minutes, Father, I do believe I can tell the time that we can walk together. We have things to talk about. 45 minutes, Father, Daddy. Fine. Walk. Thank you." She looked at her father, the twinkle back in her eye and the smile on her face, and her father could do nothing but laugh to himself. Girl, girl. You will be the death of me, my love. And Princess D turned to her stepmother. And thank you. Thank you. Stepmother had her head down, but raised it slowly and looked across to her stepdaughter and saw in her eyes the knowing that she had always been a friend. And with that, Princess D reached across the table with her hands, and her stepmother reached back, and they held fast for a moment for the next chapter of their lives. This story, The Princess's Stepmother, is dedicated and written to my stepmother and my friend, Vera Wheeler Arnold.